Mark 9:14, I'll read that first and then we'll study it. And when they came to the disciples, they saw a great crowd around them and scribes arguing with them. And immediately all the crowd, when they saw him, were greatly amazed and ran up to him and greeted him. And he asked them, "What are you arguing about with them?" And someone from the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought my son to you, for he has a spirit that makes him mute. And whenever it seizes him, it throws him down, and he foams and grinds his teeth and becomes rigid. So I asked your disciples to cast it out, and they were not able." And he answered them, "O faithless generation, how long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring him to me." And they brought the boy to him. And when the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell on the ground and rolled about, foaming at the mouth. And Jesus asked his father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. And it has often cast him into fire and into water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." And Jesus said to him, "If you can, all things are possible for one who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out and said, "I believe, help my unbelief." And when Jesus saw that a crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You mute and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." And after crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out, and the boy was like a corpse, so that most of them said, "He's dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he had entered the house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why couldn't we cast it out?" And he said to them, "This kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer." And since Jesus encourages us to pray, why don't we take a moment and pray as well? Father, we come to you this morning and we want to hear the words that you want to speak to us. We want to hear your words and not words of men. And we pray that you would reveal yourself, your truth to us so that we may know how to live, may know how to worship, and may have faith in you. In your Son's name I pray, amen. Well, this passage is about struggle. There's a lot of struggle in this passage, and we are going to look at this struggle. This is a struggle of faith. Ultimately, what we see in this passage is people who are struggling to have faith in Jesus. I was speaking to a man recently who was sharing with me about his struggle of faith, and he spoke about his wife to me, who used to go to church, and after a young child died, she refused to go to church anymore. Here is a struggle of faith, a person who struggles to believe and have faith in God. So the question this morning for all of us is, what is your struggle in your faith? Or what are your struggles as you attempt or as you believe or want to believe in Jesus and follow him? What do you struggle with? So we're going to look at two things. I'm going to have only 2 points, very, very simple. I'm not even going to have a PowerPoint, just 2 points. The first thing we're going to look at is the struggle. And the second thing we're going to look at is the resolution of that struggle. The struggle and the resolution. So first, the struggle. We see here Jesus is coming down from the mountain. He was transfigured. By the way, the last few days for the disciples were very turbulent times, or they had lots of highs and lows. From the beginning, Peter confesses Jesus as Messiah, and Jesus affirms that, and yet the next moment, Jesus tells him, "Depart from me, Satan," because he's trying to talk Jesus out of going to the cross. And then they have the mountain of transfiguration where Jesus' glory is shining forth and shining bright. And there's just a few of the disciples there with Jesus, and they're coming down from the mountain, and things are not going so well now. We find disciples arguing with the scribes. There is an argument there. And when Jesus asks about what they're arguing about, a man comes forward and he says that he brought his child to Jesus. Jesus was away in the mountain, so the disciples, he brought his child possessed by an unclean spirit, so the disciples attempted to cast it out. And so there's the description of this child who is suffering terribly. It's a very frightening, terrible thing that's happening to this child, where it says that the spirit makes him mute, and whenever it seizes him, it throws him down. He foams and grinds his teeth and becomes rigid. Luke, another gospel writer, adds that whenever the spirit seizes him, the child suddenly screams. It's like a scream of terror that our children sometimes have when they have a terrible nightmare. Except this is not a nightmare. This is a real attack of an evil spirit on this child who's tormenting him, who's causing him to suffer. That's a terrible condition. By the way, speaking of these symptoms that are described here, they sound very similar to a seizure activity that sometimes happens with present in epilepsy, or it is present when a child or a person has epilepsy. And so there's two extremes when speaking about this, what's happening, what we see, what's happening with this child. One extreme is to say that, well, there's really no demons, and people back then didn't really understand brain activity and how brain functions. So they would just attribute all these symptoms to demonic powers. But we know better now. We understand how the brain functions and where seizures come from. There's no demons. So that's one extreme. The other extreme is to say that whenever a person has a seizure, it is demon possession. I've spoken with a person once, and she said to me that I don't believe there's such a thing as epilepsy. I think it's demonic possession whenever these things like seizures happen. So that's the other extreme, to attribute anything and seizures and other things even to demonic activity. So what we find here is that we see this seizing, this convulsing, this grinding of teeth, this being thrown down, this intense suffering, physical manifestation of a terrible sort. And yet we see that Jesus and even the Father says it is a demon. The evil spirit is tormenting this boy. So it's not really an either-or situation. It can very well be that the demon is causing the convulsions of this child and suffering, or it could also be that the demon's attack and torture is so great, is so awful, is so terrible, that it causes this child to seize or go into a seizure, whereas you have sometimes overdose on medication or brain injury that causes a person who never had seizures before to have a seizure. So I think this is what's happening here, this physical aspect connected to a spiritual cause. It's not that the child had epilepsy and had something born, he was born with something and this was just the natural thing. It was the cause of demons' desire to torment, to inflict pain, to do evil, to destroy the image of God in this child. And so we see here that this father brings his child to Jesus and to his disciples to heal him. In fact, this word seizes, the demon seizes the child, is very closely related to the term that's used to describe describe dogs that are tearing up the flesh of a carcass as they're tearing this flesh. So this is the same kind of term that's used here, similar to that, where the spirit is, that evil spirit is definitely inflicting a lot of harm and a lot of pain. And so, as this father brings the child to, with hopes for him to be healed and liberated from that, obviously Jesus is not there, so the disciples attempted, I guess it's team B there, and they're attempting to heal him or to exorcise their, or to do exorcism, and they attempt and they fail. Unexpectedly, because Jesus has, in chapter 3, given them authority to cast out demons. And then in chapter 6, we read that Jesus has sent them out by two to cast out demons and heal, and it says, and they casted many demons and healed diseases. So they have casted many demons. They were good at it. They have done it. They were men with experience. Oh, you have a demon? Come forth and I will heal you of that. I will cast it out. They have been experts of that by now. They've done it many times. And now they have failed unexpectedly. And the scribes were there to see it too. Something happened. They lost their sense of dependence and inadequacy. They lost their sense of dependence on God and inadequacy, where the authority to cast out demons was not there in the first place. Jesus gave them that authority. It was derived authority. But it is so interesting how the disciples and we, just like the disciples, we often struggle with assuming that we can do it. We have done it so often. And that's why Jesus, as he looks at that whole situation, he says, "O faithless generation, how long, how long?" It's like a mother that is saying, how long, or when are you going to learn? This is Jesus, just this sadness and this exasperation, how long? And he says, bring the boy to me. So we see the disciples are failing at this task of driving out this demon because they have trusted in themselves. And that is the first element of our struggle. Remember how we're talking about the struggle and the resolution? The first element of the struggle is that we are tempted, or we lack faith in that we put our trust in ourselves. We are confident in ourselves and we stop depending on God. So it's interesting at the very end how disciples ask Jesus and they say, why couldn't we cast it out? And Jesus says, well, you should have prayed. You should have prayed. And of course, I mean, the disciples have casted out many demons. By then, they were saying, oh, we can do this. We can do it just fine. Just like us, we are so tempted to often say, I mean, we could do this. We've done it so often. We know how to do this. Why do we need to pray and depend on God? We have learned to do it ourselves. We have learned to go about our day and to do our tasks and to do our job and to do whatever we need to do and go to church and worship God. All of that we could do ourselves. Why pray? And this is why Jesus allows us, by his grace, to experience difficulty and suffering, where he allows us to be, in a sense, like in an earthquake, a never-ending earthquake sometimes, where you feel like things are just falling about and crashing, and your sense of self-confidence begins to fall too. This is what happened to the disciples, where they failed to have power over this evil spirit. This is why our prayers are often so dry and so so infrequent, so dry, like a piece of dry bread and stale bread in the back of your cupboard, where because we have lost the need to pray. We treat prayer as sort of a necessary formality that we have to go through instead of our seeking to be to depend on God and to depend on His grace and to carry us through. We underestimate the power of evil in the world and inside of ourselves. Underestimate the power of evil in the world and inside of ourselves. And that is why we lose our self or our sense of dependency and sense of inadequacy. And I will be the first one to admit this. I remember when we had our first child, we read the books. We read Shepherding Your Child's Heart and the like, and we attended all the seminars, the parenting seminars, and we were ready to make this child into a good child. And then by child number four, I remember in the hospital, Jana was asleep, and I'm walking with her in my arms. I'm walking around the room, and I'm just crying. And I'm saying, God, I can't make this child good. I can't do anything to this child to make this child have a life that's prosperous and successful and Godward. Unless you do it, I can't. And so this is the struggle of faith that we face in our life, where we struggle to depend on God because we learn to depend on self and we lose our sense of inadequacy. So, as we look down, as we look at the text, we see that Jesus says, He says, faithless generation, how long? And then I love the words when He says, bring the boy to me. I love that. Bring the boy to me. He's saying these self-confident people have lost their power to do anything. Bring the boy to me. And as we see this boy is coming, or they're bringing the boy to Jesus, we see this power of evil, the evil spirit resisting Jesus, and the boy again is thrown into convulsion, and he is on the ground, he's rolling, he's grinding his teeth. And it's interesting how sometimes coming closer to Jesus will mean that things will get much more difficult before they get better. And that's what we see here, that this boy is before Jesus, he's in convulsions, he's rolling, he's foaming. And notice the empathy that Jesus has here. He says, he turns to the Father and he says, how long has this been happening to him? Jesus is not treating this as another exorcism where he says, okay, time for another one. Instead, Jesus is saying, how long has he been suffering like this? And the Father says, from childhood, and he says that this demon, it's interesting that this demon is trying to destroy this boy. He says it's been casting him into fire and into water to drown him. This boy probably had scars on his body from all the times he was thrown into the fire. And then notice again the struggle of faith that is happening here. The Father says, but if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. This is the struggle of faith, where Jesus picks up on that and says, if you can. You know, in our kind of Pharisaic self-righteousness, we want to read these words and say, if you can, really? Do you know who I am? You're doubting me? But I don't think that this is what the way Jesus is saying this. Jesus is saying, I can do it if you believe. It's not a matter of my ability. It's a matter of your humility. He says, I can do it. All things are possible to him who believes. And this is the other aspect of our struggle of faith, is our doubting of God. This is our doubting of God, where we doubt either God's ability or God's goodness. And you know, it's easy for us to judge this father for doubting Jesus. But you know, this doubt of God is so real in our life of faith. You know, I often see parents standing by a hospital bed of their child who has been just diagnosed with something terrible. And it's such a struggle. It's such a struggle. It's everything you believe gets tested at that moment. And so the doubt of our faith, the doubts that we have in our faith, they're either doubts of God's power. Was he really able to have prevented this? Or it's of his goodness, doubt of his goodness, where we ask, how could he have allowed this? How could have he allowed this? In this case, the father is doubting God's power, Jesus, the power of Jesus. So we see that Jesus says, it's not a matter of my ability. Jesus says, all things are possible to him who believe. And now come these words. I love the words that are described here. The struggle of our faith is so vividly presented in these following words. And Jesus says, immediately the father of the child, verse 24, immediately the father of the child cried out and said, I believe, help my unbelief. So it's a mixture of belief and doubt. This is the father saying, I believe, but I am struggling so much with doubts. I am so struggling right now. Help me. And you know what Jesus does? He just heals the boy. And this is the resolution, the second part, the second point, the resolution of this. Jesus could have said in this situation, I am the glorious God that came in human form. Repent of your sin. Submit totally to me in faith. Purify your heart. And when you have done it, come to me and ask and give me your request. But Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus takes this struggling father, a father who is struggling to believe in Jesus, full of doubts, but who is saying, but help me, and he heals his son. This is saving faith. Faith in Jesus instead of yourself. Faith that he can do it. Faith in him when you say, I am inadequate, I am weak, I can't even believe in you the way I should. And Jesus acts, Jesus embraces that. So in the resolution, in this what's happening in our life, the resolution to our struggle is that we must embrace our inadequacy. We must be those who come to Jesus by faith. Faith of repentance. And you know, this is not just the faith of repentance. Our coming to Jesus must be a daily practice of admitting our weakness, admitting our inadequacy, and saying, we can't do it. Unless you do it, I can't. Carry me through. Give me strength. Empower me. This is the resolution to our struggles when we admit it, when we embrace it, and when we place our faith in the powerful Jesus. The boy is healed, and we see how the boy is healed in this amazing way where Jesus commands the demon to leave the boy and to never enter him again. What a promise. What a powerful thing. where it's obvious, looks like that demons can come back to assault a person, but Jesus says, never enter him again. And as he leaves the child looking as if he's dead, and Jesus takes him and lifts him up and gives him to his father. This is the resolution. But there's one more thing in this resolution. One more thing. When they get inside the house, the disciples ask Jesus privately. They're probably still hurting from that pain of humiliation, of failing. They're saying, so why couldn't we cast that out? And Jesus says, you must learn to depend on me through prayer. Prayer is faith turned towards God. This is what prayer really is. It's our faith that is expressed and turned towards God. It is a channel of our faith. So as we embrace our inadequacy, prayer is that which gives us confidence. Interesting. Embracing inadequacy and confidence at the same time. But prayer is the thing that gives us confidence to live our life and be victorious and to fight the battles. Prayer, which is our faith turned towards God. I was reading this description of a woman who remembers her childhood and her experience of World War II in England, in Britain. And she lived at the coast at the time, and Britain feared invasion of Germans from the coast, that they would come from that side. And so at one point, Churchill announced that they are coming, pack your suitcases. And when you hear the church bells, that's a sign of invasion, run. So this woman, she was a child at the time, she remembers how her mom packed her little suitcase. And then Churchill came on the radio again and announced that tomorrow will be a day dedicated to prayer. And so she says, I've never experienced anything like that, where I saw the next day people, children, adults, praying everywhere, on the streets, in the churches, of course, they were just praying. So after this prayer day, after where people have experienced this time of prayer, she said, Churchill came on the radio again, and he said the famous words, he said, keep calm and carry on. I'm sure you've heard of these words. Keep calm and carry on. You know, this is the power that our reliance on God through prayer gives us. It gives us this ability, to keep calm and to carry on, where we are able to trust God, trust that He will give us strength, that He will empower us to do what He wants us to do, and that we can carry on and fight the battles. This is where we find our confidence in Jesus, who says, bring the boy to me. Where we hear His invitation when He says, bring it to me, bring your children to me, and all the fears that you have about your children and what the future holds for them, bring that to me, bring yourselves to me. This is what Jesus is saying. And in that, in this resolution, we find our strength as we embrace our inadequacy and as we put our faith in Jesus through prayer. We're going to pray right now. I'm going to invite you to stand. And we'll pray that God would give us this strength and ability to trust in Him. We thank you, Father, for your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you that through this encounter that we see in this text of Mark, we see how Jesus teaches us that our confidence is not in ourselves. He teaches us to embrace our inadequacy and weakness and to come to Him. Lord, and I pray today that you would teach us to do the same, Lord, that you would strip us of our confidence in self, of our desire to carry on with our day, with our daily tasks on our own strength, and that we, instead of that, would learn to come to your Son, Jesus, in faith and trust him to give us the strength to overcome evil in our lives, evil that is around us and evil that is inside of us, that Jesus alone can give us the strength and confidence to overcome this. Lord, and I pray that you would give us and teach us to pray, to come to you in helplessness, to make that a daily, a constant thing in our life, where we learn to pray each day and each year, that our prayer would grow as we learn to depend on you and learn to bring you our needs and learn to bring you our struggles. Lord, we ask all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.